Good morning, friends. In the last class, we are discussing about the a special register in 8051, which is known as what program status word, or in brief, it is known as what PSW. It is an 8-bit register. In the 8 bits, the two registers are user definable. Two bits are used for selecting a bank, and remaining 4 bits are used for showing the condition of a flags. So in 8051, we will be discussing about the four conditional flags, namely carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, a parity flag, and then the overflow flag. So these conditional flags, basically the condition of the carry, auxiliary carry, parity, and overflow flag will change once we do some sort of operation. We'll be discussing different types of instructions in 8051 in module 2. And in that discussion, we'll be looking into what happens to carry flag, when auxiliary carry flag generates, when the parity flag will be set or reset, and then so on. And the two bits RS0 and RS1 are used for selecting a bank. So this we have discussed in the previous class. So to briefly overview it, so we have a carry flag at 7th bit, auxiliary carry at 6th bit. This is user definable bit. RS1 and RS0 are there at 4th and 3rd. These two bits are used for selecting a bank. Then there is an overflow flag. And then at the LSB, we have a parity flag. So these are the some of the instructions in which some of the conditional flags will be affected. We can see that from add with carry, subtract with borrow, multiplication, division, carry, overflow, auxiliary carry flags are affected. There are some instructions wherein only carry flag is affected. We'll discuss this in module 2. So a few examples we have done it. We have taken a data into register A, and then we have added it, and then we have tried to find out what happens to carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, and then parity flag. We have discussed one more example on that. Then we have briefly discussed about the RAM memory, which is of 128 byte in 8051. So 128 byte means the address will be from 00 to 7F. And we also discussed this 128 byte is divided into three groups: 32 bytes, 16 bytes, and 80 bytes. 32 bytes are used for register banks and also for stack. Then 16 bytes are used for bit addressable read-write memory, and remaining 80 bytes are used for read and write storage, also known as what scratch pad. This figure shows the RAM allocation in 8051. As you can see that from 00 to 1F, total 32 bytes are reserved for the banks, or bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, bank 3. You can see that bank 1 and then the stack, both are for both we are using the same location, so we need to take care of this. We'll discuss this as and when we discuss about the stack. Then from 22F is used for bit addressable RAM, and then from 32 7F for scratchpad RAM. So register banks we have discussed. Two bits are basically used for selecting a bank. If it is 00, bank 0 is selected. If 01, bank 1 is selected. 10 bank 2, 11 bank 3. So this figure shows the register banks and the RAM address of all the registers in a different banks. So as we are discussing, so PSW.4, PSW.3, bit 3 and bit 4 are basically used for selecting the bank, and these particular bits can be set or reset using instruction setb and clear instructions. So a few review questions on program status word. So first question is, the flag register in the 8051 is known as or called as. But everybody, we know that the flag register in the 8051 is known as what program status word. The second question is, what is the size of the PSW in the 8051? We also know that most of the instructions, registers in 8051 are of 8 bit, except DPTR and then the program counter, which are of 16 bits. So the size of the PSW in 8051 is 8 bits. Next simple question is, which bits of the program status word registers are user definable? As we know that Program status word is 8 bits. So out of the 8 bits, 4 bits we are using for knowing the condition of the flags, carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, parity flag, and then the overflow flag. Remaining 2 bits we are using for selecting a bank, and then 2 bits are user definable, bit 1 and then the bit 5. Then two examples, these examples we have done it. Find the carry and auxiliary carry flag status. Once you do this operation, that I request to the students to do this in a notebook and try to see what happens to carry flag and then the auxiliary carry flag. So the first instruction is move a comma hash of 0FF H, and then next instruction is add a comma hash of 01. As we don't know right what is the meaning of these instructions, as we will be discussing this in module 2, but in the previous classes we have discussed that move is an data transfer instruction. Once this instruction is executed, 0FFH is the data. This data will be copied into A once this instruction is executed. This hash indicates immediate addressing mode. Always in a hexadecimal, whenever we have a data starts with A, B, C, D, E or F, we should start with 0. The default value will be hexadecimal. So once this instruction is executed, the A will be having FF. So in binary it is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. And then next instruction is what we need to add the content of A with 0, 1. So already content of A is FF. We have transferred or copied in the previous instruction, and then we need to add with 0, 1. So 0, 1 in binary can be represented as 0, 0, 0, 0. And then 0, 0, 0, 1. So these are the binary equivalent of FF and 0, 1. Now we need to add it. So 1 plus 1 is 0 with a carry 1. 1 plus 1 is 0, carry 1. 1 plus 1 is 0, carry 1. 1 plus 1, 0, carry 1. So as you can see that last bit is 1. So for every addition, there will be a carry generated. And the MSB also, we have a 1. So 1 plus 1 is 0, and then a carry is generated. So the total answer of this addition is not 0, 0, right? Because one carry is generated. So answer is 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. So the student should be able to tell the status of carry flag and then the auxiliary carry flag, right? So you can see that if you're looking at the seventh bit, from the seventh bit, a carry is being generated. So that carry flag is equal to 1. And then status of auxiliary carry flag, as you can see that this auxiliary carry flag will be set if there is a carry generated from D3 to D4. So you can see that from D3 also there is a carry being generated. So in this case, both carry flag and auxiliary carry flag will be set. There is one more example on a similar line. So move a comma hash of 0 C2H. Again, you can see that we are starting with a number with C, so we are starting with 0, and then add a comma hash of 3DH. So we need to write the binary equivalent of C and 2. So 1, 1, 0, 0 is C, and then 2 is 0, 0, 1, 0. And then 3 equivalent in binary 0, 0, 1, 1, and then D is 1, 1, 0, 1. So again, we are doing the addition operation. So 0 plus 1 is 1. 1 plus 0 is 1, 0 plus 1 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 is 1, 1 plus 0 is 1, 1 plus 0 is 1. So you can see that the answer of this addition is FF. Along with the answer, right, we are also bothered about what is happening to carry flag and what happens to the auxiliary carry flag. As you can see that there is no carry being generated from the MSB or the 7th bit, so carry flag is equal to 0 or it is reset. And then the status of auxiliary carry is, right, again it is related to whether a carry is being generated from D3 to D4. Again, you can see that there is no carry generated from D3 to D4 or lower nibble to higher nibble. If you can remember, nibble is nothing but the group of 4 bits. So in the second case, carry flag is equal to 0 and also auxiliary carry flag is equal to 0. And also, if you want, you can look for the parity flag also. But as we have discussed, the parity flag will be set if you have an odd number of ones, and it is reset for even number of ones. So we have 8 ones, so parity flag is equal to 0. So this is basically a few review questions on the what we have studied in the last class. So next we will be discussing one more important register of 8051 known as what stack pointer. If you are looking at the RAM of 8051, total 128 byte, we are dividing into three groups: for register bank, for bit addressable, and then for scratch pad. And then in the register banks, if you are looking at the bank one, and then the stack, right? We have mentioned there. So the stack is a section of the RAM used by the CPU to store information temporarily. So basically, the main objective of using stack pointer is I have some information. That information may be data or may be address that can be stored on the stack. So at this point, you may be having doubt that we have already registers, 8 registers in each bank. That means 32 registers, plus along with that we have register A, accumulator, and register B. Then what is the necessity or need of one more storage area known as what stack, and there we want to store the information temporarily. Even though we have 34 8-bit registers, and these 34 registers may not be sufficient for storing the information temporarily. So in such scenario, always the programmer uses the stack memory location, and they will be storing the temporary information on the stack. The register used to access the stack is known as what stack pointer register. That is what we are discussing. As we know that stack pointer is again a 8-bit register. That means it can hold the value from 00 to FF. And then one more important aspect about stack pointer is when the 8051 is powered up, when you start the 8051, the default value of stack pointer register is 07. That means the RAM location 08 will be the first location that can be used for stack. So if you look at the RAM allocation of 8051, this figure, right, you can see that from 00 to 07 we have a register bank R0 to R7, and from 8 to 0F we have a register bank, and also in bracket we have written as stack. So what we are discussing is when a microcontroller is powered up, when we start it, so the default value, it starts with 07. So the next value is what, 8, is the first location wherein you can store the temporary data. That is what we are discussing. So we have shown here, right? So when the microcontroller is powered up, the stack pointer will contain the value of 07 default. This is what default value. So the after 7 we have a value of 8 that comes in the first location of register bank 1. That is the first location, and that can be used for storing the data. Now if you want to use the stack, if you want to use the stack, that means if you want to store the data temporarily in a memory location, then we need to use the two instructions, one for storing, the other instruction for retrieving. So whenever you are doing a program, whenever we want to use the different sort of instructions and then different registers, sometimes we need to store the data either in registers, sometimes we may need to store the data or the address at the stack. So the for storing the data or the address of a CPU register in the stack is known as what, push instruction. And for retrieving or loading the same information from the stack is known as what, pop instruction. So basically the two instructions, the push instruction and then the pop instructions, are used for storing and retrieving the data or the address from the stack. Along with for storing and retrieving, these two instructions are also used whenever we use a term known as what, We'll discuss that. What happens when we use the push instruction? So when we use the push instruction, the stack pointer is pointing to the last use location of the stack. For example, in the previous slides, we have discussed that when a microcontroller is powered up, it is showing up to location 07. So that 07 is the location, and then the next instruction will be what? Once you push it, it will store the data, and then SP will be incremented by 1. For example, the first location of stack is, let us assume it is 08, and then we are using the push instructions. If you use the push instruction, the data or the address, whatever we have, that will be stored at the 08th location, and then stack pointer will be incremented by 1. That means now stack pointer points to 9. If you are using two push instructions, then at 09 the data will be stored, and then again it will be incremented. So after 9 will go to 0A. Again, we need to keep in mind that we'll need to discuss in terms of hexadecimal number systems. Whereas in the POP, exactly the opposite will takes place comparing to push instructions. So with every POP, the top byte of the stack is copied to the register specified by the instruction, by the POP instruction, and then stack will be decremented by 1 position. So if you are assuming that now the stack is pointing to location 0A, and now we are using POP instruction, so it will retrieve the data and it will be incremented. So if the stack is having address of 0A, it will be decremented, and now it shows the value of 09. So these are the importance of the push and then the POP instructions, which are used in 8051 microcontroller. So with the figure, we can discuss the operation of push and then the POP instruction. This is what the stack. You can see that register will be having the values 21, 56, 45, some random values we have. So if you are using the push instruction, so this 21 will be copied into the address mentioned by the stack. And once this is copied, then the stack pointer will increment by 1, as we are discussing. POP will decrement it. So once the 21 is copied in address 00, stack will be incremented. Now it shows the address of 01. So next is what, if you are using again one more push instruction, 56 will be copied in address of 01, and again it will be incremented to 02. So at this location, again if you use one more instruction, 45 will be copied, and again it will be incremented, and now stack pointer points to 03, and then so on. So if you want to store all these data temporarily on the stack, so we need to use the push instructions. After each push instruction, the data of that particular register will be copied to the stack. Along with copying, it will increment the address by 1s. So if it is 0, it will be incremented 1. If it is 5, it will be incremented by 1. Now it shows the value of 6. Whereas in case of POP instruction, exactly the opposite will take place. You can see that if you are using a POP instruction, so 12 will come out to a location register. So data will be copied here, and it is decremented. So push and POP operations are exactly opposite to each other. So this can be explained further with an example. So in this example, we need to show the stack and the stack pointer from the following instructions. So the instruction, we are using three instructions, move R6 comma hash of 25H. Again, all these instructions are of data transfer type. In these, all the three instructions, we want to copy the immediate data into the register. So move R6 comma hash of 25H, move R1 comma hash of 12H, move R4 comma hash of 0F3H. Once these instructions are executed, R6 will be having the value of 25, R1 will be having the value of 12, and similarly R4 will be having the value of 0F3. Again, as we have discussed, you can able to differentiate between the numbers, say 25 and 12, and then F3. So F3 is preceded by 0, as we have discussed that if the number is from A to F, we should start with 0. Again, the values are hexadecimal values. And then after these instructions, we are using the push instruction, right? Push 6, push 1, and then push 4. So what happens once we use, or once the microcontroller executes this push 6 instruction? So you can see that the push 6 is nothing but R6, push 1 is nothing but R1, push 4 is nothing but R4. So what this push instruction will do is, the R6 will be having the value of 25, that is already being executed. R1 will be having the value of 12. R4 will be having the value of 0F3. And we are assuming that, assume the default stack area. So default stack area is what? When the microcontroller is powered up, we know that the stack pointer is pointing to 07. So once we use the push 6 instruction, so R6 will be having the value of 25. You can see that at the address, with address 08, we have a data of 25, which is there in R6 after executing push 6 instruction. And once you execute push 1 instruction, this 1 is related to R1. R1 has got a value of 12, so that will be stored in a location 09. Because as we have discussed, once a push instruction is executed, along with storing the data in an address, it will increment by 1. So initially we have a address of 08, once 25 is copied, and then it will increment. So 08 now will be incremented, now SP points to 09. So 12 will be copied at 09, and again we have one more push instruction, push 4. So push 4 is related to R4. R4 will be having the value of 0F3. So 09 will be incremented by 1, so it becomes 0A. So F3 will be copied into a stack address having 0A. And then again it will be incremented. It goes to the 0B. If you have a one more data, then that data will be copied into 0B. In these examples, we have only 3 push instructions we are using: push 6, push 1, and then push 4. And then we are assuming the default stack area. So our stack area will start with 08. So 08 will be having the value of 25. 09 will be having the value of 12. And 09 will be having the value of F3. This is how the push operation takes place. Now we need to look at the pop instruction, right? What happens when you use the pop instructions? So if you are looking at the stack, stack addresses are from 08, 09, 0A and 0B, and these addresses has got a sum value. 8 has gotten value of 60, 9 has gotten value of 76, 0A has got a value of F9, and 0B has gotten value of 54. And then we are using 3 pop instructions: POP 3, POP 5, and POP 2. So the first, the POP 3 instructions will be executed. As we know that the basic function of POP is what? To retrieve the data and then decrement the stack pointer by once. So POP 3, you can see that after POP 3, what is happening? The 54 data will be copied into register R3, and this 0B will be decremented by once. Now stack pointer is pointing to a address of 0A, RAM address of 0A, and 0A has got a data of F9. Then again we are using one more instruction, POP 5. So once this instruction is executed, the register R5 will be having the value of F9, and further this will be address will be decremented by once. Now you can see that stack pointer is pointing to 09, and then after that we are using POP 2 instruction. So once this instruction is executed, the 76 data will be copied into register R2. So you can see that exactly the opposite is happening in the POP instruction if you are comparing with push instruction. In push instruction, the data is being stored in the location, address location pointed by the stack pointer and stack pointer is incremented. Whereas in case of pop instruction, the data will be retrieved and then the address will be decremented by once. Now the reason for incrementing stack pointer after the push instruction. Now you may be having doubt that is it possible to design a stack pointer in a reverse case. Reverse case in the sense we want to decrement the stack pointer after using push instruction and increment after using the pop instruction. Is it possible to do that? Right. Now answer to this question is we need to look at the RAM location in 8051. So if you are looking at the RAM location in 8051, this is the first address of the stack. 08 is the first address of the stack pointer, because when a microcontroller is powered up, as we have discussed, the stack pointer will point to 07. So default value is 07. So next location is 08. So you can see that there is a 08, and what we are saying is if you are using a push instruction, after every push this address will be incremented by once. So 8 will increment to 9, 9 will increment to 0A, 0B, 0C and then so on. So this push, after every push instruction, this address will increment. Finally it goes to the maximum value of 7F. But on the other side, if you want to decrement it, right, so the initial value is 08, if you start decrementing it, right, so 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 and then 0, that means we have very few addresses. We have only 7 to 8 addresses below the stack default stack address. For this reason, the microcontroller is designed in such a way that after every push instruction, stack is incremented by 1, so that we can use the more number of addresses. So coming to the discussion of reason for incrementing, right, we want to make sure that stack is always growing, right? Always growing is what we are starting with 08 and it grows up to the maximum value of 7F from the lower to upper addresses. From where we got this 7F, this 7F 00 to 7F is what? The total 128 bytes which are available in 8051. So the basic reason for incrementing is what? We want to grow the stack, ensure that stack will not reach the bottom of the RAM and consequently run out of the stack space. So if you decrement it after push instruction, right, we will be run out of the RAM after 7 to 8 push operations, because we don't have any addresses available below 0, because 00 is the starting address, 7F is the last address. So if you decrement the stack pointer after push instructions, as we have discussed that we would be using RAM locations, right, after 8. So if you decrement it, we'll get 7, further decrement it 6, 5 and then so on. And also these 7, 6, 5 up to 0, these addresses belongs to registers of bank 0, and this is a default register bank. So for this reason, it is always advisable, or it is designed, 8051 is designed in such a way that stack is always growing after the push instruction. After using pop instructions, it will decrement by 1. So when 8051 is powered up, register bank 1 and stack are using the same memory space. Again, if you remember the figure of RAM location, the bank 1 and then the stack, right, we are using the same memory space. So we need to reallocate another section of RAM to the stack. That means there are programs wherein if a programmer is using the registers of bank 1, then in that case we cannot use the stack in that case, because stack and bank 1 are using the same addresses from 08 08 09, A, B, C, D, E and then F. If you are using other than bank 1, if you are using bank 0 or bank 2 or bank 3, then there will not be any problem. But problem comes if a programmer wants to use the registers R0 to R7 of bank 1 and then the stack, then it is not possible. In that case, this stack can be reallocated. Keep in mind that the bank 1, bank 2, bank 0, bank 3 cannot be reallocated. There is a fixed addresses for these all banks. But obviously the stack can be reallocated. So we'll discuss how to reallocate the stack. So one more example of reallocating the stack. So examining the stack, show the content of the register and stack pointer after execution of the following instructions. So if you are looking at the instruction, move stack pointer comma hash of 5fh, right? This is the initial value. In the previous slides, what we are discussing is we are taking the value of the stack pointer is default value, that is 07. So 07 and then the next value will be 08. That is what the stack location. Whereas in this program, we are reallocating the stack from 07 to some other memory location. If you take 5F, so the next address will be 60. So the starting address of stack will be 60. Now we can look at the program. Move R2 comma 25, move R1 comma 12H, move R4 comma 0F3H. And then we are using three push instruction, push 2, push 1, and then push 4. If you are looking at the same program with a default stack pointer, right, 25, 12, and then 0F. Here in this case, we are taking the default stack address. So default stack address is 07. So now all these 25, 12, and F3 will be stored from 08, 09, and 0A. But now problem here is what? If a programmer wants to use the bank 1 and then the stack pointer. So in that case, 08, 09, 0A, 0B belongs to bank 1. So we cannot use these addresses. So in that case, what we are saying is we can reallocate the stack pointer. So stack pointer can be reallocated by simply using one additional instruction, that is move stack pointer hash 5FH. So after 5FH, we have a next location is 60. So you can see that now the addresses of stack are starting from 60, 61, 62, 63. So start stack pointer is 5F, that is mentioned here. So this is a variable number. You can take any number, right? 7F being the highest number. So you can take 55, you can take 63, whatever value you want, we can take it. If you, for example, if you take 65, then next address will be 66. So after execution of these three move instructions, R2 will be having value of 25H, R1 will be having value of 12H, and R4 will be having value of F3H. And then we are using the next three push instructions, push R2, push R1, and push R4. You can see that after every push instruction, so 25 will be copied in an address 60, increment stack pointer by once, it becomes 61. Then we are using push R1, right? R1 has got a value of 12, so 12 will be copied at 61 location, increment it by 1, so now the address will be 62. Push 4, R4 has got a F3 value, so 62 address will be having data of F3. So once this this program is executed, these set of instructions are executed, we'll be having the data of 25, 12, and F3 in an address 60, 61, and then 62. So we need to be careful when we are writing a program, and in the program, if you want to use the registers of bank 1, if you are using the registers of bank 0, bank 2, and then bank 3, there is no issue. Right, straight away we can take the default stack pointer value, that is 07, that means from 8 onwards. Now few review questions on the stack pointer. First is the simplest question: what is the size of the stack pointer register? Again, answer to this question is, as most of the registers in 8051 are of 8 bit, so stack pointer is also 8 bit. Next question is, what happens after every push instruction? With each push instruction, the stack pointer is dashed by 1, whether it is incremented or decremented. Next question is, with each pop instruction the stack pointer is incremented or decremented. So we know that after every push instruction the stack pointer will be incremented by 1. With each pop instruction the stack pointer will be decremented by 1. Again, if you are looking at the other types of microcontroller or microprocessor where we are talking about 16-bit microcontroller or 16-bit microprocessor where stack pointer will be of 16 bits. In such scenario, the stack pointer needs to be incremented by 2 or decremented by 2. We also discussed the reason for incrementing the stack pointer after every push instructions because we want to grow the location, memory locations. Next simple question is, what on power up the 8051 uses RAM location as first location of the stack, right? The answer to this question is right, 07 is the first location whenever a microcontroller is turned off. Again, you need to keep in mind that whenever a microcontroller is turned off, all the content of the registers will gone, right? Because these are the temporary locations, all the registers in 8051 or this stack pointer contents will be erased once the microcontroller is turned off. So we need to take care of, if you want to store the data permanently, then we need to use the main memory. The other question is, on power up the 8051 uses bank dash for register R0 to R7. So the default bank used when a microcontroller is powered up is bank 1. Next question is, which register bank is used if you alter RS0 and RS1 of PSW by the following instructions? So we are using two instructions, set B PSW.3, set B PSW.4. If you remember the program status word, this bit 3 and bit 4 are basically used for selecting the banks of 8051. So these are also known as what, RS0 and RS1. So what we are doing here is we are making RS0 and RS1 is equal to 1 because we are using instruction set. Default instruction is clear. So this bit is also 1, this bit is also 1. That means RS1 is 1 and RS0 is also 1. If you remember the table for selecting a register bank, right? So 1-1 means what? We are selecting the bank 2, bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, sorry, bank 3. We are selecting the bank 3. If you want to select bank 2, wherein we need to have a 1 and 0, so in that case, we need to make RS1 is equal to 1 and RS0 is equal to 0. So accordingly, we need to use only one instructions. So these are the few review questions on the stack pointer. So basically the important thing we need to keep in mind is a stack pointer is of register is of 8-bit. For using the stack, we need to use the two instructions, push instructions for storing and pop instructions for retrieving. After every push instruction, stack pointer will be incremented by 1, and after every pop instruction the stack pointer will be decremented by 1. The default location and the default register bank when the 8051 is powered up is 07 and then the bank 1. And we also need to know the reason for reason for incrementing the stack pointer. And one more important parameter we need to keep in mind is it is not possible to use the registers of bank 1 and then the stack at the same time. So if you want to use the registers of bank 1, then we need to reallocate the stack pointer by using a simple instruction of what, or initializing the move stack pointer with some value. Then coming to the pin diagram of 8051, in the initial class of microcontroller we have discussed that 8051 is a 40 pin IC, dual in DIP package, dual in package. It has got the 40 pins. All the 40 pins has got different function to do. If you are looking at the 8051 pins, so pin number 1 to pin number 40, So different pins will be performing different functions. You can see that there are many pins which are doing the multiple functions. So if you remember the block diagram or architecture of 8051, what we said is a microcontroller is what? It is a CPU along with RAM, ROM, IO ports, interrupts, then crystal, everything will be there on a chip. So you can see that there are multiple functions which are there. So if we want to perform a individual function with each pin, then we may need more than 40 pins. So for reducing the number of pins, many pins will be doing multiple functions. Only you can see that from pin number 1 to pin number 9, and then 18, 19, 20, then 29, and then 40. There are very few pins which are doing only single functions, but rest of the pins are doing multiple functions. So you can visualize what all the blocks we have on the microcontroller with the pins. As we have discussed, 8051 has got ports. There are four IO ports which are there on a 8051. So you can see that there is a port 0, and also we have discussed that each port has got 8 pins. So port 0.0 to port 0.7. So all these 8 pins are basically used for using the port 0. We'll come back to what is the other function of these pins. And then there is one more port, port 1. So port 1.0 to port 1.7. So port 0 and then port 1. And then we have port 2 also, port 2.0 to port 2.7. Again, we'll come back to what other function these pins are doing. So port 0, port 1, and then port 2. And then we have a one more port, port 3, port 3.0 to port 3.7. Again, these pins are doing some other functions also. So this 8051 along with CPU has got four ports also. If you're looking at the other pins, right, you can see that there are two pins, pin number 18 and pin number 19 are used for XTAL1 and XTAL2. This 8051 comes with different frequency, right? Along with that, you can connect the external frequency also to 8051 for its operation. There are different frequencies that can be used, 10 megahertz, 12 megahertz and 14 megahertz. So that oscillator is connected here, and then there is a ground pin. Then we have a PSEN pin. Then we have a ALE pin, address latch enable. Then we have a EA pin. Then we have a VCC, that is for power supply. Power supply 5 volt DC is required. Now we'll be discussing the function of this each pin in detail. Along with this, we have also discussed the concept of the different buses which are used in computer or microcontroller, known as what address pins and then the data pins. We have discussed that data pins are bidirectional, and basically they are used for carrying the data to and fro. And address pins are basically used for generating the address in order to access the data from the memory. So you can see that in 8051, we have 8 address lines. So 8 address lines here in a multiplexed format. AD means address signed data. So pin number, these 8 pin numbers are used in a multiplexed format. That means we are using these pins for address as well as data. And then from 21 to 28, we are using A8, A9 to A15. That means in total we have 8 address lines, and then 8 data lines, and then 16 address lines. We have discussed that the significance of address lines, more address lines will give you more amount of memory, but again on the flip side, the circuit complexity will be more or cost will be more. And we have a 8 data lines. Again, it is advisable to have more data lines, but 8051 has got only 8 data lines and then 16 address lines. So in the next class we will be discussing in detail about the function of each pins which are used in 8051. Thank you.